knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
As we move through this anthropology series, we are getting closer and closer to modern humans, and in this tutorial, we will get closer still as we discuss the genus Homo. Homo is the genus modern humans belong to, and the oldest members show up in the fossil record around 2.8 million years ago, found in East Africa. The first species assigned to genus Homo is Homo habilis, a hominin whose name means handyman due to its association with some of the first stone tools. All members of genus Homo, just like Australopithecus before it and Paranthropus beside it, are bipedal. This means their postcrania look very much like what we see in humans today. Homo species thus have an anterior foramen magnum, a bowl-shaped pelvis, a valgus knee, three arches in the feet, and an inline big toe. However, it is in genus Homo that we see major changes in the skull. The brain case explodes in size. The face gets flatter and more gracile, and the teeth get small. Homo habilis is nothing to write home about in its brain case size, with the range dipping into what we see in the Australopiths at 509 to 777 cubic centimeters. It appears much more derived than what we see before, however, in its face and teeth. Homo habilis has a flatter face, smaller teeth, and a more parabolic palate than Australopithecus before it. Homo rudolfensis is also found in East Africa and appears around 2 million years ago. Its brain is bigger than what we saw in Homo habilis, at a range of 750 to 825 cubic centimeters. At this point, hominins have crossed the midway point between Miocene apes and modern humans in terms of brain volume. Homo rudolfensis has a significantly flatter face than Homo habilis, and evidently a reduced brow ridge, or supraorbital torus. This hominin is not directly associated with tools, but given its brain size and coordinates in time, it was certainly capable of making them. These members of early Homo are thought to still possess some primitive characteristics in their postcrania, curved phalanges, and longer arms. This may suggest that, in addition to meat, early Homo was still exploiting resources from the trees. Overall, Homo habilis and Homo rudolfensis have a mix of basal and derived characteristics, but they appear far more human than anything that came before. For a while, there was a question as to whether Homo habilis and Homo rudolfensis represented two unique species, or a male and female of a single sexually dimorphic species. A close examination of the hominins reveals the likely answer. Most apes are sexually dimorphic, with males presenting a variety of deviations from the female morphology. Males tend to be larger than females in most apes. In gorillas and orangutans, males are twice the size of females. In chimpanzees and bonobos, males are 30% larger than females. And in humans, males are 7 to 15% larger than females. Gibbons, the small apes, are the exception and are sexually monomorphic. Males and females are the same size. Because of their larger size, however, male apes may present larger brow ridges, a sagittal crest, and a larger mastoid process. In the case of Homo habilis and Homo rudolfensis, the smaller species, Homo habilis, has the larger brow ridge. This is a mixed signal if the two species were a single dimorphic one. The smaller individuals, presumed female, should have the smaller brow ridges as well. Instead, it appears that Homo habilis is an older, perhaps more basal-looking hominin as compared to the larger-brained, flatter-faced Homo rudolfensis. Australopiths lived for nearly 2 million years, Paranthropus even longer than that, and yet neither of these hominins saw a large jump in brain case size like what we have seen just in 800,000 years of genus Homo, which was 509 to 825 cubic centimeters across the two Homo species we have discussed. So what caused the brain case size to increase in the Homo lineage? Currently, the thinking is that it had something to do with the acquisition and consumption of meat. Today, our brains consume 20% of our daily metabolic intake. Brains are profoundly energy expensive, which is why animals tend to hit a gray ceiling, a maximum brain size for a given niche. However, meat is energy dense, meaning the regular incorporation of meat into the diet of an animal that previously only rarely ate meat raises the gray ceiling of the population. Late Australopithecus and early Homo present an interesting possibility. These hominins may have begun by exploiting bone marrow. Bones are easy to find and usually left behind after lions have had their fill of a carcass. Hominins, unlike many other scavengers, could break these bones open using the stone tools they had only recently figured out how to make. Access to marrow reduces the amount of time a hominin needs to forage for fruits, and allows natural mutations in favor of larger brains to proliferate rather than die due to expense. Bigger brains allow hominins to innovate, making better tools. This allows them to exploit even more resources, growing bigger brains and innovating further. One can quickly see what a feedback loop this creates. And the trend would continue up through one of the most variable hominins we currently know of, Homo erectus. Let's continue moving through genus Homo now.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.